You will be already, you're hungry, so anyway, you have already a copy of your opening statement.
Yes, Your Honor. I submit, Your Honor. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, members of the council. Good afternoon, Dean RAUL PANGALANGAN.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
My former professor at the UP College of Law. Yes, Dean, first of all, you are 53 years old now. Is that correct?
That is correct, Your Honor.
Okay. Quite young dun sa standard ng mga aplikante, di ba?
Opo, tama po.
And if appointed Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, you will serve 17 years.
That is correct, Your Honor.
Kanina, when we were interviewing si yung first na interview dun sa incumbent Justice Abad, parang very very clear rin yung stand niya dito eh. At least sa akin, ang sinabi niya, dapa na nga eh. Ang diba, parang ganun sinabi niya, dapa na ang Korte Suprema after impeachment, plus lalagyan pa ng outsider, lalong dapa, di ba? Dadagdagan pa. Ganun natin sinabi. So meaning yung at least yung sa isa sa mga insiders or incumbent, na siyempre prefer nila yung insider, no? for many reasons probably, and probably yung isa sa reason doon yung age, isa doon yung experience. So paano mo pupunuan ito, Dean, if ever na ikaw yung ma-appoint or ma-nominate namin muna at ma-appoint, how would you address yung problems na to na, you know, outsider, ito experience yung mga kasama mo doon, matatapakan mo, or hindi naman masasapawan mo yung iba, hindi na magiging Chief Justice. Diba? So, how would you address these problems?
Yes. Thank you, Your Honor, for the question. First of all, hindi ho ako bago sa sitwasyon na yon. I became Dean at the age of 40. My predecessor was then retiring at the age of 65. He belonged to class 58 of the UP College of Law. I was born in 1958. So the gap was rather big. It did not pose any problem to me. My successor also was actually eventually retired in office. So if the question is whether being young comparatively is a disadvantage, it can actually be turned into an advantage. So, for instance, I enjoyed wonderfully the support of my most senior colleagues in the faculty, and they helped me throughout my deanship. I enjoyed I had two terms as dean of the law school, and that is why for me, when I look at the issue, for instance, of what people now call a divided court, a court with well-identified camps. That is a situation I have faced before, of presiding over highly articulate, very intelligent, assertive faculty members who have different opinions, and getting them to work together under my leadership and achieving the goals that I have set out for the institution.
Doon naman po sa, di ba yung Article 8, Section 1, yung expanded jurisdiction. Gusto ko lang, very briefly lang, Dean, ano ang pananaw mo doon sa expanded jurisdiction of the Supreme Court vis-a-vis doon sa political question?
Yes. Thank
Just
you.
Very, very, very briefly lang.
Opo. Your Honor, we must look at that provision in the context of history. Why did we write paragraph 2? To the expanded definition of judicial power? It was based on our experience under martial law, that the activists at that time turned to the courts for sanctuary, for refuge, and invoked the rule of law. And that is why, with the triumph of EDSA 1, Cory appointed constitutional commissioners who wrote that entire approach, that entire philosophy, into the 87 Constitution. So when we now arrive at this situation of what they call the expanded, expansive exercise of judicial review, of judicial activism, it is not that we are pointing fingers and accusing people. It is that we are seeing the inexorable march of history, which brought us to that moment. But, Your Honor, it is now 25 years since the 1987 Constitution. A quarter of a century since the since EDSA 1, the foundational moment of the post-Marcos constitutional order. That is long enough for us to look at whether this judicial aggrandizement has served the country. And I think the lesson is it has not. And that is why I respectfully submit that I think the time has come to review that, to reinterpret that clause without necessitating any constitutional amendment. All we need are tried and tested judicial doctrine. The case and a controversy requirement, the rule on standing, political question doctrine, the rule of primary jurisdiction. Lahat po yan available sa juzgado if it wants to define its place within our democratic system.
Ang ibig niyo sabihin na during those times, parang dun sa delineation na yon, na because of that expanded jurisdiction, sumobra ang korte doon. Para naging activist siya. Yun ba yun? Yes or no, siguro lang ang answer dito.
Yes, sir.
Yes. And there are Can you examples. Cite one case?
Well, sir, the cases that are quite famous. Luzon Petrochemical, Garcia versus Board of Investments. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, there's the Manila Prince Hotel case. These are the notorious cases along that line of analysis.
Okay. Yung political, yung maliwanag na political question. Meron?
Well, Your Honor, I defy politics in terms of the way the court would push a certain decision toward a desired conclusion. Okay. In other words, I call it the manipulation of text.
On the issue naman of JDF, di ba? Judiciary Development Fund, at saka yung SADJ, Special Allowances for Judges. Matagal-tagal na rin itong mga issues na to, no? Pag ikaw yung, let's say, from the outside, appointed Chief Justice, anong ma-offer mo dito na improve yung system of, let's say, transparency? Ibig sabihin, paano mo nakikita ito birang minamanage ngayon ng Korte Suprema, itong JDF and SADJ? And meron bang pagbabago pag ikaw ay naging Chief Justice?
Well, Your Honor, again, if you look at it in terms of the developments over the years, the JDF, the power to dispose of the JDF was... Well, actually, strictly speaking, reposed on the Chief Justice. It is just over time that it was expanded to include the collegial participation of the rest of the court. That is where we stand today. And I think that that is a good development which I propose to sustain, and also to sustain the goal of transparency. Because this is a fund that, because of the fiscal autonomy of the court, beyond reach of the other branches.
Is it being managed well right now, to your opinion? Is it being managed well?
Well, Your Honor, just based on informal information from conversations with members of the judiciary, I feel that there is a sense that the fund can be managed in such a way that there will be more benefits to
Do you know how much is this?
No, Your Honor,
fund?
I'm not.
You don't
know.
So hindi mo alam na billions ito.
I am aware that it billions. Is that big, yes, Your Honor. Well, okay. It was, in fact, the bone of contention in the impeachment of Chief Justice David, and I was amicus counsel in that case. I was designated by the court as amicus counsel.
Okay. Okay, Dean, so, doon tayo sa... Dati kasi, di ba, matagal na kayong hinihirang as nominee. Di ba? Ilang beses na ata, even before pa ako na-appoint dito or na-designate ng Kamara.
Apo.
Tapos sabi niya, si Dean Raul Pangalangan, palagi yan eh. Pero hindi na appoint yan. Di ba?
Apo.
Kahit dito sa kahit Justice, Associate Justice.
Apo.
So, tingin mo may pagbabago ba ngayon na Dean, na let's say, pag nakonbinsi mo kami dito at isa ka sa Lunes, no, July 30, Lunes ng umaga, na isa ka dun sa 3 to 5, for example, 3 to 5 na nominees ng JBC. Tingin mo yung pagbabago ngayon na hindi na perennial na nominee, hanggang nominee nila lang?
Shortlisted but not appointed. Yes.
Tingin mo, realistically,
Well, Your Honor, the most dramatic difference is the events that brought us here, namely the impeachment of a of a sitting Chief Justice. Never before happened in Philippine history. And also, my first nominations happened under President Arroyo at that time, a long time ago, I think 10 years ago. And so I think conditions have changed, Your Honor.
So may pag-asa ngayon, tingin mo?
One can hope. Hope springs eternal, Your Honor. But in fact, Your Honor, just to show you the effect of that of the impeachment trial, had it not been for that event, no outsider will even be sitting before the Judicial and Bar Council to be considered for this office. No outsider will even have the nerve to accept a nomination if he is nominated, because it's just too much of a burden, of a an overwhelming barrier. But because of those events, here we are.
Last question, Your Honor. Ito sa academe kasi, di ba, yung merong perception. Like kayo po, sa, di ba, academe talaga kayo. At parang sinasabi nila sometimes pag sobra na doon sa field na yon, parang giging out of touch of reality na tayo. Yeah. Na tayo na sa realidad. At pag Chief Justice ka ng Korte Suprema, definitely, dapat talagang alam mo yung reality. Diba? Yung the congestion of...
the dockets, yes.
Di lang dockets eh. Yung doon lang, yung jail. Lahat yan, talagang bababa ka eh. Personal experience, lahat yan. So, yung paghahanda ba din, paghahanda mo sa sarili mo, with all these years dun ka sa academe, tingin mo magiging sapat ito? Coming na yung Chief Justice, hindi biro ito. Hindi ito madali. Hindi ito parang ideas lang lahat. Diba? Hindi siya ideas, hindi siya concept. Diba? Not just the vision, even if you have the vision, eh, baka hanggang vision lang. But you should implement that. You should make things happen. Kailangan natin ng action dito sa susunod na Chief Justice. Do you have it?
I respectfully submit, yes, Your Honor. Because fortunately or unfortunately for me, as a Filipino law professor, I still have to involve myself in the practical problems of the day-to-day life. So on two points, Your Honor, in terms of practical experience in the law, I was in fact the University General Counsel for a while. And in that capacity, I had to handle the loftiest issues on academic freedom before the Supreme Court, to the nitty-gritty of the contracts with security guards, to the discussions with labor union. So in terms of getting involved in the practical problems of that lawyers face, I have faced them. I am chairman of the Bantay Katarungan. We continue to handle cases before the courts, some of them before the Supreme Court. But Your Honor, on the second point, well, on the point of administration, of actually running an organization, well, Your Honor, I had two terms as dean of a public law school, which means that I'm familiar with all the difficulties of dealing with government procedure and of the bureaucracy, and of the need basically to supervise a whole range of an alphabet soup of committees and organizations, and divide by time and attention among them.
That's all, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Dean.
Well, thank you, Congressman.
Attorney Cayusa, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, Dean.
Good afternoon.
In your presentation at the IBP forum, you propose the depolitization or the depoliticizing of the courts and a managerial approach for judicial reform. Now, before I ask you to expound on that, maybe you'd like to identify what particular problems were you actually addressing by making these proposals?
Oh, okay. Your Honor, on the first part, you see, Your Honor, whenever we speak about the institutional autonomy of the judiciary, judicial independence, we think in terms of immunizing the appointments process from politics. And the chief mechanism, of course, is the Judicial and Bar Council. We think of fiscal autonomy, the budgetary power of the court, so that it can operate and work without constant intrusion from the political branches of government. And what I wanted to point out, Your Honor, in the IBP forum, is that there is a completely separate and distinct source of political pressure on the court. And that is of courts, of the court being drawn into political controversy. And the best proof, Your Honor, is that today there is an official court spokesman. Inherited wisdom says that a court speaks only through its decisions and nothing beyond that. And that was the position, in fact, of the court. I still remember when it was first proposed. That was the official position of the court. Why will we hire someone to interpret our decisions for us? And yet today, it is an entrenched position. Why? Because our people have higher expectations of accountability. They want someone to announce a decision on mass media and explain it to them in popular terms. So, Your Honor, that is the, for me, the other angle of pressure upon the courts. And that is why, for me, faced with that pressure, the court is, as I've said earlier, under pressure to respond to some of the, let us face it, there will be rallies, there will be concerted campaigns in the newspapers for or against a certain decision, for or against a certain party. And we have to strengthen the court so that it can stand stand firm, stand fast against such pressures. Yung po yung, that's where I was coming from, Your Honor.
Okay. I guess for some, or for many, especially the court employees, they're really more concerned, how will the next Chief Justice improve our quality of life, how we are able to perform our functions as court employees? Well, how would you address those concerns?
Oh, Your Honor, I can actually build upon my own record as an administrator at UP. I always push for improved. In fact, that is. Thank you, Your Honor, for your language. That is how I called it: the quality of life, of our employees, and creative ways to improve their salaries and their benefits. So that is a cause to which I have long ago committed myself. I would like to think I delivered upon that hope vis-a-vis my own employees. And for the court, the Congressman Tupas asked earlier about the JDF. There is also, of course, the budgetary allocation from the national government. It is my hope that those are the sources by which that can be tapped to
ensure. Could you be more specific as to how you would improve the quality of life? I mean, of course, it helps if their income is augmented.
Yes.
But other than that, is there something else that you may want to propose that would improve the quality of how they live, so that they'll be encouraged also to improve their services?
Well, Your Honor, of course, enhancing salaries and benefits would be the key element. And that is accessible via the JDF. So for me, Your Honor, it is not an iffy prospect. As iffy, for instance, as saying that we must secure a greater budgetary allocation from the national government. Certainly, that is something that we should hope for. But I think within the JDF, that should be doable.
Thank you, Dean. Now, the courts are only as good as the people that you put in them. So that is a bigger responsibility of the JBC. But I read in your opening statement that you have some criticism as to how, the process by which we nominate judges, as well as the requirements. Now, first of all, let's go to the requirements, the documentary requirements. Which one did you find difficult to comply with?
Your Honor, I had to get, I think, 8 or 9 clearances from different government agencies. And if I put myself in the shoes of a young lawyer looking for an entry-level position in the judiciary, and he doesn't have access to staff, and he would have to drive from one office to another, we are basically taking back with one hand what we give with the other. In other words, we encourage him, we push him to apply, and then when we're about to apply, we make it so difficult. I propose, Your Honor, a very practical solution. These are doable through interagency agreements that the JBC can arrange with all the government agencies involved. Just to show you, Your Honor, the details and the nitty gritty of this. I imagine they might resist it because there will be an income. There will be foregone income because right now there is a fee that is charged for these clearances. But again, it is my hope that that is an element that the JBC can negotiate with these offices, so that when the employee, well, when the applicant puts together his file before the JBC, he can focus on the substantive stuff, the things that he has written, the things that he has done, rather than getting the purely ministerial clearances, which can be dealt with purely administratively without burdening the applicant. So that is my. I hope it wasn't seen as a as an attack upon the institution. In fact, Your Honor, given a choice between the JBC system that we have today and the pre-martial law system under the 35 Constitution, I do go for the JBC system because I have we have seen how that operated, that we borrowed the system from the US. I have read how it operated before under martial law. I have seen on TV how it operates before the U.S. Confirmation proceedings, and I think that the JBC system is the preferable system. So it's not a fundamental criticism. But yes, I did present those suggestions before the integrated bar. The other, Your Honor, is a more proactive sense of recruitment, of spotting good material out there. It is difficult to do it, certainly from the standpoint of the council working alone. But I think the council can also join hands with the integrated bar, with the local chapters, with the with retired judges. These are the people who have either the time or the energy to spot good material out there, to encourage them to apply. I've seen it happen. And I think that a more proactive recruitment of material, and Your Honor, starting not just with young lawyers, but trying to spot them even at the stage of law school, those with a judicial temperament, should have a good effect.
Thank you on your suggestions, well taken. But it may interest you to know that we've already started addressing the problem on the documentary requirements. For instance, you can actually just phone in your request to the IBP and then pay online. You need not go there personally to get a clearance. And in so far as the ombudsman clearance is concerned, you may actually apply for it online if you're not aware yet that that's...
I'm not.
Okay, then we're on that track. But other than that, there's no other way for us to determine whether you have all the qualifications and none of the disqualifications. So, like I said, the point well taken. Now,
Your Honor,
this will probably be my last question, considering the time. Could you cite instances in your legal career which would show that you have the qualities, not just the experience and the knowledge, needed by the next Chief Justice, particularly when it comes to drawing your colleagues in the court to agree with you, to build a consensus in order to achieve a vision and to accomplish the reforms that you are setting forth?
And you're asking, Your Honor, for specific episodes in my own career. Well, I will have to fall back on the my experience as dean at the UP College of Law, because the presiding over a faculty would require me to bring together the faculty to accept measures that perhaps normally might be resisted. I'll give details. They might be boring for outside an academic setting, but even the simple exercise of a teaching evaluation survey, where teachers are basically graded by the students, can be resisted. The simple exercise of having a dialogue between which we have institutionalized, by the way, between the faculty and students, is something that otherwise might be resisted. And I'm very pleased to say that those reforms have taken root. And in fact, today, long after I have stepped down, they continue to be carried out. So what I'm saying is that handled otherwise, with less care and with less sensitivity. These are reforms that might be resisted by the more traditional faculty, but in that context were accepted.
Thank you, Dean. May I just make a follow-up? Because you mentioned in an evaluation process among the professors of law in the College of Law, there is also need for us to look into the possibility of an evaluation system also for the performance of judges in order to aid all agencies, including the JBC, for promotion, for perhaps incentives, if that is something that can be done, you know, in the future, so that those judges who actually perform better are rewarded accordingly. Not just, we don't have to wait for a judicial excellence award, you know, to happen. If they perform silently and they're able to declog their dockets, and perhaps they should also be given the and afforded the right, the merit and the recognition. So with that, Mr. Justice Peralta, I have no further questions. Thank you. Good luck, Dean.
Salamat po.
Attorney Mejia.
Thank you, Justice Peralta. Good afternoon, Dean Pangalangan. Alam niyo po, meron kasi kaming usapan dito sa JBC na meron kaming, nag-impose kami ng time limitation among ourselves. Kaya medyo mahigpit po ang aming chair sa pagbibigay ng panahon sa opening statement, no? Tinitingnan ko po yung opening statement ninyo, mukhang maikli lang naman, at nasa live coverage tayo. Willing po akong ibigay yung panahon ko sa inyo kung gusto ninyong basahin yung opening statement.
Salamat po. Thank you, Your Honor. I have actually delivered parts of my opening statement, but let me just summarize. Your Honor, the court today works under two historical moments. The first I have already mentioned, the 25th anniversary of the 1987 Constitution. And the second I have likewise mentioned under questioning by Congressman Tupas, which is the recent impeachment of the former Chief Justice. But that then brings the court into the question of continuing the path of judicial activism or exercising judicial restraint. And I'm more on the side of judicial restraint. Now, admittedly, at this stage of our history, it is difficult to be that restrained because, for instance, many of the large causes, social and economic equality, environmental protection, these have all been codified into law. So even if a court says that, you know, it doesn't want to get involved in substantive policy matters, there is no choice. There is a codified either right or obligation under the rules. But as I've said earlier, there are also countervailing judicial doctrines by which a court can defer to the political branches of government and enable them to perform their respective duties. And for me, the important thing for a court is not to dissipate its legitimacy needlessly. In other words, there are some political debates that are best left to the political process. And that for a court to jump into the fray will therefore actually bring down the court from its from its Olympian perch and reduce the court to just another political player, open season to the elected branches of government. And that is the difficulty there. And that is why, in fact, which brings us back to why at some point the court had to create the position of an official spokesman, because the court had to answer the criticisms from the political branches of government, which were completely free to comment and to debate, whereas the court was, by tradition and by law, limited just to its functions, to its adjudicative functions. The common thread, Your Honor, therefore, is that at this particular moment, a Chief Justice would have to rise above the, I call it the grayness of reality, to see the place of the court in the grand constitutional design. And I will, my preferred definition of the judicial power is, and here I quote, the shaping and application of those wise restraints that make us free. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you. Some of the questions that I had for you were already addressed in your with the questions of, or by the questions of Attorney Cayosa. So let me go to some of the questions that were tweeted, no? And we will give you an opportunity to address this. Apparently, a number of UP professors opposed your appointment as dean. Can you please clarify or clarify this particular incident?
Yes, Your Honor, and thank you for giving me a chance to address that that point. I stood for the deanship for the first time in 1999, and there was a group of professors who supported a different candidate. I took part in all the public forums because that's part of the UP system. The dean nominees appear in public forums. I took part in all those forums. Well, unfortunately, their candidate did not, but they did campaign quite actively for their candidate with the posters and all. But you know, as history shows, Your Honor, I won and they lost, and that group of faculty members protested my appointment. I am again very thankful for my most senior colleagues in the faculty for having supported me throughout that that battle. And I went on to serve my first term of 3 years. My performance was reviewed at the end of those 3 years, and I was given a fresh mandate with the full support of my faculty.
My final question, for another suggested question. How should the Philippines and China resolve the issue on the Scarborough Shoal?
Your Honor, there are two ways to look at it, the legal and the political. On the legal, the most important point, whether we're dealing with Scarborough or Spratly's, is to define how we characterize the rocks at Scarborough Shoal. Those are five isolated rocks the only land jutting over the water even at high tide at Scarborough. In contrast, for instance, to Spratly's, where we have real islands existing. And having defined how we characterize the features, that's the generic term, the features, then we can determine whether these are islands that we must own because they are land and which therefore generate their own maritime zones, their own territorial sea and exclusive economic zone and continental shelf. That is one, to see them as islands, or to characterize the Scarborough either as rocks, which generate only a territorial sea, not an exclusive economic zone, and also to lay our claim over that part of the shoal which is actually underwater, and consider them as part of our exclusive economic zone squarely under our sovereign rights. That is the legal part. Of course, Your Honor, on the political part, it is I will have to defer to our foreign secretary on this point, but I do support his position that we have to multilateralize the dispute. It is not purely between a small country, the Philippines, versus a big country, China, that it is actually a multilateral dispute among several ASEAN countries vis-a-vis China, over which the ASEAN has holds a common interest.
Thank you, Dean. Good luck. Thank you, po, Justice Peralta.
Justice Lagman, please.
I have only very few questions because of most of the questions which I have prepared have already been asked, and I found the answer of the dean very satisfactory.
Salamat po.
Okay. Now, past chief justices have been remembered for the judicial reforms they have instituted during their incumbency. Now, Dean, if you will be fortunate to be nominated and appointed as the next Chief Justice, can you describe to us the face of a Pangalangan Court?
Okay. That is a difficult question, Your Honor. Your Honor, you mentioned that chief justices were identified by the administrative reforms.
Yes.
I would like the legacy, if I'm given the opportunity, to be both administrative and judicial.
Judicial, yes.
That is for a court which spoke with a clear voice. In other words, I see it as part of the role of a chief justice to bring his colleagues together toward a core agreement on the most important issues. To speak with a clear voice on constitutional norms, and so for me, it is a court that will be identified with living up to the loftiest dreams of the 1987 constitution, because that was a constitution brought about by a rupture between the martial law era and the post-Marcos era. So I'm trying to find a brief way to describe that. Well, Your Honor, it will be a court that exercised its judicial power judiciously. That is how I will summarize it.
Okay. Now, my last question, Dean. Now, if you will be the next Chief Justice, can you tell us what will be your top three priorities upon assumption of office?
Okay, Your Honor. I can think of just two right now, but I'll think of a third along the way. Well, Your Honor.
Okay.
The most urgent and the most obvious is the consolidation of the institution. Because we are here today because of the of a dramatic and I would say traumatic process by which a chief justice was unseated, and I think the institution has to consolidate itself both internally within the Supreme Court at the level of the justices, at the level of the staff, the court vis-a-vis the Supreme Court vis-a-vis the lower courts, all the way to the trial judges, and the for that matter, the court vis-a-vis the other branches of government. That, of course, will be sensitive, but I think it is something that ought to be done, and the best time to do it is as soon as a new Chief Justice takes over, so that he can take advantage of the momentum of that appointment. That's the first. Mm-hmm. The second, Your Honor, is... which brings me back to what I call the managerial approach. Mm-hmm. You see, Your Honor, in terms of administrative reforms within the courts, I have been part of the Supreme Court committees, many Supreme Court committees in the past, and my feeling really is that all the bright ideas on judicial reform have already been expressed. Okay. I'd rather not reinvent the wheel. I think we are now at the stage of implementing all the all those wonderful ideas. And it is in the process of implementation that we have to ask ourselves, how come some reforms are not easily embraced by the practitioners, for instance, that even if the judge wants, even if the judge, for instance, has a policy of no postponements, what if both parties basically agree and present it as a fait accompli? So for me, the administrative reforms which have been laid out from the action plan for judicial reform from 2001 to 2006, I think were written well because they looked at the court as an administration, as an organization. And now we are at the stage of implementing that. Well, in terms of the third, Your Honor, in much the same, I will do exactly what I did in my past administrative positions and address the question of staff morale and staff benefits. For me, the institution thrives upon its lowliest employees, and these are the staff whose benefits are minuscule compared to the rest, whose problems fall through the cracks can be forgotten in the course of, you know, the more earth-shaking decisions faced by the highest administrators. And my feeling then and my feeling now is that that is something that ought to be given importance.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dean, and good luck.
Salamat po.
Justice Hermosissima, sir.
Well, good afternoon, Dean.
Good afternoon, po.
I have interviewed and nominated Dean Pangalanan several times before, revealing his excellent qualifications.
Salamat.
And so I will ask no more questions.
Oh,
thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Secretary Mosngi.
Magandang hapon po, Dean Pangalanan.
Good afternoon po, sir.
Someone earlier mentioned that the Supreme Court right now is a wounded court after the impeachment. You touched on this very briefly kanina sa mga katanungan sa inyo. Pero specifically and more definitely, I hope, if you are appointed Chief Justice, how will you unify the Supreme Court and resolve the sense of fracture and a divided court that it is right now?
Thank you, Your Honor. In fact, this gives me a chance to explain more detail what I explained earlier. Your Honor, it is the process of reaching out, which is important, to reach out to all members of the court, or for that matter, people outside the court, to reach out, to sit down, and to talk. That is why, in operational terms, what is worrisome there is that that is a process which requires a lot of meetings, a lot of time sitting down and talking to people. But in my experience, also given Philippine culture, it is those face-to-face meetings, not necessarily big meetings, they can be quiet conversations, that can heal wounds, forge working relationships among estranged parties, and hopefully over time can bring together a fractured institution to work together.
Thank you for that, Dean. Your reputation precedes you, Dean Pangalanan, but I believe that no matter how impeccable your professional record may be, criticisms are inevitable. To your mind, what was the worst personal or work-related criticism against you, and how did you deal with this before?
Well, the worst criticism I received was in that episode mentioned earlier, already before the council, and that was when I was opposed as dean of the UP College of Law. And the criticism was, I was a dean that was loved by no one except his wife. My wife is here, Professor Elizabeth Pangalanan, a professor of persons and family relations. And I remember that when that was first uttered in public, someone nudged me on the elbow and said, hey, that must be a good thing. That even if the whole world turns against you, your wife is still there beside you. So if your question, Your Honor, is the worst thing that was said, I would take that as the worst. Fortunately, mercifully, providentially for me, by the time I presided over my first faculty meeting, I realized that it wasn't true, that I in fact enjoyed the support of my colleagues and especially my most senior colleagues in the faculty, and they sustained that support over the next 6 years of my deanship.
Chairman, I have no further questions. I wish you well and best of luck, Dean Pangalangan.
Salam. Just a follow-up question, Dean. What happened to those who were opposing you?
Well, Your Honor,
Did they continue teaching or did they take a leave of absence?
Well, one, Your Honor, was already on leave of absence at the time I took over the opposing candidate. Because he went on leave under my predecessor, because he was the opposing candidate then. And when, anyway, some of them went on leave, and I granted their leave. They applied for leave, and I granted it. I will not stand in the way of people's plans.
Did they rejoin the faculty during your incumbency?
In fact, Your Honor, some who opposed and who continued teaching were so welcome to continue teaching.
They did not continue teaching.
Well, I would say I'm absolutely sure about one who actually continued teaching, continued to oppose me, but that's okay for me. Okay. I was dean, and I welcome all voices in the faculty.
The others did not anymore teach.
The others went on leave and found opportunities elsewhere. And again, I am happy for them if they found those opportunities.
The other question is that you are from the academe, no?
Apo.
Some of the applicants are private practitioners.
Apo.
My question is, what is your edge over these applicants, practitioners?
Your Honor, the luxury of a professor is that he can take a broad view of things. That if I worked, for instance, with my father, who was a litigator.
How is he? He used to appear before me. How is he?
Oh, he is turning 87 this year, Your Honor. His health is
Does he still appear in Sandigan Bayan? No more?
No more, Your Honor.
Okay, good. Then go ahead with your answer.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Your Honor, for asking, and I will convey to him your question. And I realized when I was working with him that I was fortunate that I was able to do some teaching. And now, I principally do teaching. Because if I was buried in the routine of everyday deadlines, I will not be able to step back and look at what is happening. Concretely, for instance, Your Honor, practitioners would go to the courtroom and look at the calendar, see where they are, what number they are. Of course, there would be side comments saying, "Oh, there are 40. Siguro mga tatlo lang may hearing dyan." You see, it takes the luxury of a professor to look more deeply into that setup, and that is why the court eventually has adopted all these reforms. The court is piloting this continuous trial system. But I think that someone immersed in that situation will have neither the time nor the energy nor the inclination to reform that. He will just see it as, well, today I'm number 10. Maybe I will have to wait for about 1 or 2 hours, but that's okay. That's my morning for today, and I will move on for my next hearing, my next deadline. So it takes the reforms will have to come from those who are either released from that burden, or who would be tasked precisely to take that long view. And that is the advantage of the professor.
Your forte is public law?
That is correct, Your Honor.
And international law?
Oppo. Okay.
You are in favor of, supposing there's a charter change, once you are a Chief Justice, no? You're appointed a Chief Justice. Are you in favor of retaining the power of the Supreme Court under Article 8, is that Section 1?
That is correct, yes.
Based on grave abuse of discretion to review even the acts of the two branches of government?
Yes. Your Honor, my short answer is I'm rather conservative on many things. And on this point, for me, I'm prepared to accept the text as it is. Because, Your Honor, it is not a problem with the text. It is a problem with those who interpret the text. Because there is a way to read that expanded power without, you know, dragging the court into the political thicket. Of course, ideally, Your Honor, we can refine that language. After all, grave abuse of discretion, originally under Rule 65, was a check on judicial discretion, discretion which is highly circumscribed. And now we apply the grave abuse of discretion test on open-ended political discretion by all instrumentalities of government. That is, of course, that opens the floodgates. But I've said there are ways to, there's sluice gates by which to rein it back. So my focus, Your Honor, is less on the amendment of the constitutional text. It is more on the refinement of the of judicial interpretation.
Okay. Last question. I do not know if this is your answer will be very long, but it is my last question because already 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Can you name or state rather? Three major problems that now beset the court, and you can you give solutions, or what your solutions would be? Mahaba ba yon?
Opo, eh,
mahaba. Three major problems, then state or give the solutions.
Okay, sir. Let's start with the most familiar, the recruitment of the best and the brightest into the legal profession. I have been bar examiner twice.
Oh, you should have been included when you apply. You should have been appointed a long time ago.
I'm sorry.
You said that you have to recruit the brightest. Then you should have been already appointed long time ago as member of the court.
Oh, well, thank you, Your Honor, for the kind thoughts. But Your Honor, the bar exams. During my IBP presentation, I openly, publicly recognized the most radical reforms carried out by the Supreme Court, and I said that the way it was implemented was the way to go. This is the shift to the MCQs, the multiple choice questions. I appreciated as a professor the careful way by which the reforms were phased in. It was gradual. It was with full consultation with the law schools, their faculty, and their deans. Of course, the process has Mr. Chairman, I was referring to the bar exam reforms. The process continues today, but that is the way to do it. Of course, I know that I'm promoting another applicant before the court, but I do appreciate the work that Justice Abad has done. But for me, I was on the Supreme Court Committee on Legal Education that reviewed this. The original proposal on MCQs was for a sitting panel of examiners.
That's right.
The Comelec says the finalist will be
on to other things. Is the best guarantee that there is no institutional memory. In other words, Your Honor, kung may mali this year, either in the design of the questions, in the allocation of points, in the focus of the cases, there is no institutional memory by which to carry that forward. And so it's like, every bar examiner starts afresh. And for me, it is important to have a way by which to to collect the wisdom, the accrued wisdom over the years, so that the examinees are not caught by surprise, so that they have a relatively a stable expectation of the range of questions, etc. That is on the selection of lawyers. Second, Your Honor, the teaching of ethics. You see, Your Honor, with ethics, it is easy to do more of the same thing. In other words, more points in the bar exam, I mean, greater percentage in the bar exam, more courses to be taught, more seminars, more MCLE credits required. Your Honor, I think it is time to focus less on the quantitative and more on the qualitative. It is the approach. Because with the current approach, by teaching students and lawyers more and more of the ethical rules, they also learn more and more of the loopholes. And then at that stage, what is the stock response?
That's how lawyers are.
Well, Your Honor, precisely, that's my point. We must transform the hearts and minds of lawyers. And that is why, Your Honor, what is the, I call it a cop-out. They say that, oh, we are just teachers. We can just shape their minds. The shaping of their hearts will happen in their homes, in their churches, elsewhere, anywhere else, but not the classroom. I contest that, Your Honor, because the teaching of ethics should not just be teaching about rules. I call it, my preferred approach is recognition of moral choice. That lawyers must realize that in their day-to-day life, the most mundane decisions are actually moral choices. And that is why they must recognize the moral dimension of otherwise mundane choices and act upon them. So sure, the acting upon them is still a matter of conscience, but they have to confront it as a matter of conscience and not to see it purely as a matter of the technical application of rules, which will then pave the way for a lawyer given a choice between the loophole and the right thing to do, to choose the loophole. Well, the third, Your Honor, just so that I can move forward, is something that I have discussed earlier, which is the managerial approach managerial and proactive approach to the recruitment of judges, because it is my sense and it is my hope that that we have a changing profile, Your Honor, of students today. If you notice, 10 years ago when I was dean, there were about 80, 85 law schools. Today, I think we have 120. It used to be that UP was the only law school with full-time professors and full-time students. Now there is a trend toward more and more full-time students. If one looks at the changing profile, there is a parallel transformation in the profile of the careers that that they take. For instance, Your Honor, if we look at the recent bar exam reforms in Japan and Korea, it used to be that the passing rate in Japan was like 4 to 5%, Korea was 2 to 3%. Now they have instituted reforms. They have copied our system of education and our bar exam system. They're aiming at 20 to 25. The difference, Your Honor, is that because they belong to the continental tradition, students choose their career path toward the last 2 years of their life as law students. In other words, they already choose their focus, whether they would like to be members of the judiciary, members of the prosecutorial service, or members of the practicing bar. And maybe we can take that direction. We have already actually taken one major step in that direction, the Philippine Judicial Academy. And I have for a long time been on the faculty of the PhilJA. And my experience there is that until PhilJA, it wasn't just that the judges had no opportunity for, in effect, continuing legal education. For me, it was more than just the academic. For lack of a better word, I call it the social. They had no opportunities, they had very little opportunity to sit down and exchange notes, exchange experiences as judges with fellow judges on the day-to-day work that they face.
You are in favor of MCQ.
And we now break briefly from our live coverage of the JBC screenings to bring you this report just in. The release order for Gloria Arroyo has been signed. Gretchen Malala joins us on the line now. Gretchen, what do you have for us?
Yes, the SIRTC judges who had already signed Bernie Taper's for former President Gloria Arroyo. Bernie's order is ordered to police chief superintendent William Barnage, the deputy of Police Security and Protection Group. DMTC director, Dr. Ona Legazpi, will also be receiving a copy of the release order. Sheriff Rodelio Benviaje will be proceeding first to Kamkrame, giving a copy of the release paper to the Office of the Police Security and Protection Group. Next, Sheriff Benviaje will be proceeding to the VNMC and will be giving Dr. Ona Legazpi a copy of the release papers. Mrs. Arroyo is required to fill out first a personal data form, including the address and telephone numbers where the court can contact her. She would also be undergoing fingerprinting. After the PNP had checked her records, if Mrs. Arroyo had no other pending warrant of arrest, she is free to go. Gigi?
Gretchen, so you mentioned that the sheriff is going to proceed to Camp Krame to give a copy of the release order to them. So does this mean that definitely there is going to be a security escort or a security team to facilitate the safe release of Mrs. Arroyo?
Yes, Gigi. What Sheriff Rodelio Benvaya says that after giving a copy of the release order, the PNP will be checking the records. And it's also up to them to see if they would escort Mrs. Arroyo. But the PNP should be going to DMMC, and the PNP will be the one releasing and clearing Mrs. Arroyo if she has no other pending warrant of arrest.
Mm-hmm. And do you have any information at all as to where Mrs. Arroyo might proceed from the VMMC?
We still haven't have any information. We were asking her legal counsel, attorney Raymond Montes, but he said that he hasn't talked to Mrs. Arroyo yet.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, thank you for that update, Gretchen Malala, the reporting from the Pasay Regional Trial Court, and confirming that former president, the release order for former President Gloria Arroyo has been signed. The sheriff is on his way to Camp Krame to give them a copy of the release order, and then the sheriff will proceed to the VMMC. And the JBC interviews have wrapped up. Former UP Law Dean Raul Pangalanan was the third to be on the hot seat this morning. Pangalanan is the ninth nominee for Chief Justice to face the JBC. He has made his position clear about how he believes that it is time to review the 1987 Constitution. Pangalangan, who is also a columnist, also stressed the need to better communicate court decisions to the public. He also was asked about his priorities, and he said that the consolidation of the institution is most urgent for him. He said that there were difficult circumstances that brought them where they are now. He said that we are here today because of the dramatic and the traumatic process by which the Chief Justice was unseated. Another priority that he mentioned is he says it's important to address staff morale and staff benefits. He also said that it's important to implement administrative reforms in the judiciary. Earlier, we also had lawyer Rafael Morales at the hot seat at the JBC interviews, and before that, Justice Roberto Abad. Later this afternoon, we're expecting Justice Brion, Commissioner Sarmiento, and lawyer Manuel Cianco to face the JBC. Stay with us. Dateline Philippines is coming up next.